Excellence without effort is as futile as progress without preparation. Growth without change is as unseemly as evolution without a purpose. Every year, InnoVision curates interactive, knowledgeable, and insightful webinars to enable the students to traverse their potential and aid them in their pursuit of progress. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to one and all present here. Please keep in mind the following pointers before the webinar begins. Kindly rename yourselves as name underscore roll number. Video and audio have been disabled for all attendees. If you get disconnected from the meeting due to any technical glitch or network issues, you can rejoin the meeting using the same link. In case of any query, kindly address it through the chat box to XCS underscore queries. I repeat, in case of any query, kindly address it through the chat box to XCS underscore queries. Please maintain decorum at all times during the meeting. Failing to do so will lead to serious repercussions. A feedback form will be rolled out in the chat box at the end of the webinar. All attendees are requested to stay back and fill the same in order to avail the credits. On behalf of the Xavier's Commerce Society, it is an honor to welcome you to the first calendar event of the Department of Commerce of St. Xavier's College, the much-awaited InnoVision 21, A Pursuit of Progress. Xavier's Commerce Society believes in nurturing the development and holistic growth of every student in St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. As we introduce you to InnoVision 21, we would first like to play a short video introducing the Xavier's Commerce Society for the incoming batch of Xavierians.
15 years ago, the vision of a few Xavierians manifested into providing college students with a platform to fulfill their dreams, nurture their development, and chart their destiny. Today, their vision stands tall as one of the most sought-after societies and the representative body of the Department of Commerce, the Xavier's Commerce Society. The aim of the society is to encourage Xavierians to be leaders. It fulfills this objective by providing its members hands-on experience in organizing and executing diverse events of indomitable stature. As we invite you to the Xavier's Commerce Society, here are a few glimpses of the exemplary events we host. Introducing you to our first event, InnoVision, which celebrates the spirit of human knowledge and wisdom. The sessions consist of various career-oriented seminars conducted by eminent personalities and prominent institutions which aid students in their personal and professional growth. This year, it will be held soon, so stay tuned to all our social media handles to be updated. Up next is Inception, an event organized specially for the first-year students. It serves as an arena for them to exhibit their corporate prowess and offers an impelling and enriching experience to the students through which they can showcase their wisdom in the realms of the dynamic business environment. We also host Excalibur, which is one of the largest intra-college management fests in the country and the biggest in St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. It is an opportunity to experience enthralling events, exhilarating simulations, and face cutthroat competition to create a niche for yourself. XCS began its journey in 2006 with the launch of YouThink. It is the annual journal of the Department of Commerce and has the distinction of having its very own ISSN ID, which makes it an internationally recognized journal. Its 11th volume was also acknowledged by the Honorable Prime Minister of India, Shri Narendra Modi. In the past, it has been associated with dignitaries like Shah Rukh Khan, Sachin Tendulkar, Lord Jeffrey Archer, and Brett Lee, to name a few. With the 16th edition setting sails this year, it has established itself as a force to be reckoned with. We also host Corporate Prodigy, an event designed exclusively for high school students with the aim of giving them the experience of corporate events and exposure even before entering college. This year, Corporate Prodigy 2021 was successfully held on 7th and 8th August. Every year, the Xavier's Commerce Society embarks upon an endeavor to give back to society in the most optimum and unique way possible. Last year, we were successful in providing food to approximately 500 needy people across different areas of Kolkata. As an ideal end to the academic year, Insignia is the flagship event of XCS and attracts participation from international colleges as well. It aims to provide a platform for undergraduates to anchor their business acumen by augmenting corporate realities into simulations and tests individuals' stride to corporate prowess matched against the best institutions across the globe. The Xavier's Commerce Society has always stood as the cornerstone of excellence, empowerment, and self-development. As you look forward to molding yourself into a well-rounded individual over the course of these 3 years, XCS awaits you.
Thank you for the video. Our webinar today is on the topic Intricacies of Data Analytics. Our speaker for today is Ms. Shivangi Agarwal, who is an alumnus of St. Xavier's College, Kolkata. She has completed her bachelor's in commerce with a specialization in finance. Having cleared 11 actuarial papers and securing AIR-1 in CT7 Business Economics, she also has a teaching experience of 3 years. Ma'am has also pursued an integrated program in business analytics, IPBA, from IIM Indore and specialized in hard skills like Excel, R programming, machine learning, predictive analytics, and VBA. Ms. Shivangi has mentored 2,000 plus students in actuarial and data analytics domain and has also conducted workshops in some prominent colleges in India like IBS Hyderabad, IIM Indore, and St. Xavier's College. Ma'am, we are grateful to have you amidst us today. Without any further ado, we would request ma'am to begin with today's webinar. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you so much for such a beautiful introduction. It feels really great to be back to my alma mater and sitting on this side of the screen, actually. And it was, I think, 5 years back that I used to sit at that side, and I used to actually watch all. I have been part of all the InnoVision seminars which we used to have. Thank you so much, XCS, for giving us this opportunity. So I'll just straight away start with today's webinar, and I hope you all enjoy, and it'll be really knowledgeable for all of you all. I hope my screen is visible. All right.
Yes, okay. Ma'am.
Okay. Thank you so much. Okay. So let's start with today's topic, which is intricacies of data and business analytics. This is a word, this is a topic which is really, really, you can say, in trend right now, right? So let's start with what is actually data and business analytics. What is data? Data is, it's a raw form. Data can be anything. It can be an audio, it can be a video, it can be a newspaper article, it can be the different tweets, it can be Instagram stories which you post. All of these things are actually data, right? Now, how do you use this data? It's not valuable in its raw form, right? You have to use your business acumen, you have to use analytics to actually convert this raw data into something which is useful information to us, for giving us useful insights, for making better decisions, to uncover various hidden patterns in the data sets, and to draw conclusions out of it, right? So that is what data and business analytics is all about. You are actually using your business acumen, your analytics skills to convert this raw data into its useful form. So when we're talking so much about data, let's talk about something called as big data. As the name suggests, it's really huge in size and it's growing exponentially with time. Big data is getting bigger day by day. Where is this big data word coming from? Where is this big data getting generated from? Let's talk about last year, 2020. Do you all know that every person, each person of us, we created approximately 1.7 megabytes of data every second? Let's take a few examples and let's talk about day-to-day things which we use actually. So let's talk about Amazon. More than 6,600 shipments were made every minute last year in India and across the world, sorry. And we have more than 41 million messages sent across on WhatsApp every minute by every person across the globe. Then we have Instagram, more than 350,000 Instagram stories were posted by us or across the world by all the Instagram users every minute. Let's talk about LinkedIn. So more than approximately 70,000 jobs were applied for using LinkedIn. So don't you think that so much of data which is being generated in the form of videos, audios, text messages, tweets, So all of these data are actually useful when you convert it into an useful form. Let me ask you a small question. I want all of you all to please use chat box and, you know, reply there to all of us. So Facebook bought WhatsApp, right? Do any one of you not know that what was the amount? What was the amount for which Facebook bought WhatsApp? Any one of you just quote your guess in the chat box so that I can read. Come on, everyone. Anyone, if you just a rough guess. Okay. So out of, I can say, now this is a data which I am generating. Out of 1,000 students, there's no one who can give me a rough guess about the quotation. Okay. Okay, so it was actually $19 billion, $19 billion for which Facebook acquired WhatsApp. Now, do you think it's only for revenue? That's the first thing. The second thing is all about data. It's all about data. The WhatsApp stories which you post, the WhatsApp messages. And do you know WhatsApp business? WhatsApp business has grown multifold. There are small businesses who are actually working in WhatsApp itself only. There is the only platform they work on. So you can imagine how Facebook thought of about the data and bought WhatsApp and now earning millions out of it, right? So all of these data which is being generated, only 0.5% of this data is being used and actually being analyzed into a useful information. So all of that 99%, 99.5% of the data is not utilized. Is that what we are trying to say? Yes, it is. So you can understand how undermining, how underestimating we are about the data and its advantages, right? Let me give you a few examples now. So data and business analytics are actually used across all the sectors. You just name it, be it education, be it telecom, e-retail, insurance, government, finance, risk management, healthcare sector, anywhere you go, analytics is used. Anywhere you go, data is being generated. Let me start with a few examples, okay? Our very favorite, Netflix. For all of you over here who are actually subscribers of Netflix, you all get those must watch or next movie suggestion, next series suggestion. How do you think you get those? It's all about based on your past searches, your watch data, how much duration you watch, you use your Netflix for throughout the day, what series do you prefer, what kind of movies do you prefer, which actors, actresses do you love. So on based of all of these, you get those suggestions on Netflix. And those suggestions are 99% of the times very, very accurate. Let's talk about the House of Cards, the series House of Cards. So Netflix actually used analytics and they analyzed that people who watch the British version of House of Cards also preferred watching series which were directed by David Fincher. Why not combine these two elements together and create the US version of House of Cards directed by David Fincher? And actually, you all know how brilliantly the show did and how much millions they earned through this show. So that is how Netflix is constantly using data and data analytics to grow their revenue and to retain their subscribers. And they actually save around approximately $1 billion every year on customer retention. Next, we have the e-commerce giant Amazon. So again, a short question. I want all of you to please interact with me. Be very interactive. This is a Saturday morning. All of you, please open the chat box and answer me this question. How many of you actually feel that Amazon recommends you those products which you have recently searched for, maybe on Instagram or Facebook or Flipkart, anywhere, or Google? How many of you actually feel that when you open Amazon, you get the recommendations which are actually for you? So, okay, many people are raising their hands. Great, great. So I definitely feel that. Suppose if I'm searching for any product, there's a new cosmetic coming in and I'm searching for it, or maybe I'm talking about it with my friend, the exact same or the type of product is shown to me on Amazon. So that is how it's well linked, right? That is how actually the Google ads the Facebook ads, the WhatsApp ads, the YouTube ads actually work, and they earn millions out of it. So Amazon actually believes in everything under one roof. So there is nothing you cannot find on Amazon, right? So they have this recommendation engine. And how does the recommendation engine works? It collects a lot of data. Since its inception in 1990s, it actually has collected so much information about its customers. What are you ordering? Where are you ordering from? Which credit cards you are using? What is your age, gender, marital status? All of these things are actually used, and then on the basis of these things, you are recommended through the products. And most of the times, you end up buying one of those products. Moving on to the next example, risk analytics. Suppose I go to SBI Bank for a home loan or for an education loan. Do they straight away give me the loan? No. They ask you several questions and they do a background check. What is my name, my age, how much I'm making every month? Did I ever purchase anything on EMI before? Was I able to pay all the EMIs properly, which is my equal monthly installments properly? Was I able to pay back my loan earlier, if any I've taken? So all of these things are actually put in together. They have an algorithm, and then they decide that whether this person will be a bad debt for us or not. If I am a risk-free person, or if I have a less chance of making a bad debt, then they will give me this particular loan. They check my CIBIL score. On the basis of the CIBIL score, I am given the loan. This is how you actually use the data, create a useful insight out of it, that whether this person will be a bad debt for us or not. Only when I am out of that risk stage, I will be given the loan amount. Next, do you all know that even in the healthcare sector, you can use analytics? So there is a company called Propeller Smart Inhalers. They actually create inhalers which are sensor-based, and these are actually linked to the data-driven mobile app. So basically, whenever I'm using this inhaler, it not only records the duration for which I'm using the inhaler, but also the environment, the weather conditions, what is my diet. All of these data are taken together in this app, and this is straight away goes to my doctor. That is how my doctor recommends me my medical, maybe my new medicines, my new lifestyle change. That is how this small piece of inhaler is actually doing wonders, right? And saving many lives. Next, we have speech recognition. So speech recognition, you might have used Alexa, Siri, Google Assistant, all of these things. And when you speak, it just changes it into text, right? Let me show you all an example over here. So I'll just open my MS Office over here and I'll just dictate one line to my MS Office. Just see to this. Hello, XES. Thank you for organizing this amazing workshop. Thank you, XCS, for organizing this amazing workshop. Okay. So there were some glitches. I said XCS and it read something else. I said workshop, it read something else. That is how it's developing day by day, right? So this is how, just by just listening to my accent, just listening to my speech, it converted into the text. And when I say it's converting it into text, you can imagine that every time it's updating. The algorithms which are created, it's actually updating, getting updated every time. So when you get those updates on your cell phones, when you get those updates on your laptops, it's just not for nothing. It's exactly, maybe small, there was a small glitch that is being overcome. There was something which were not there earlier. So every moment it's actually getting updated every time they end it. That is how speech recognition works. And actually they use a proper machine learning behind it, which is known as NLP, natural language processing, wherein they understand my accent, my language. It can be Hindi, English, Tamil, many languages are coming in and they convert it into text, right? So it's really great for us. Moving on, so next we have this entire examples which I was giving you all on the basis of data analytics. So it's not about just analyzing the data or maybe deriving just inputs out of it, outputs out of it. It actually, it's a process, the entire process, and it's consisting of the entire data and business analytics process. Let me just give you a brief idea about it. So it starts with data collection. When I say data collection, it can be in any form. You are collecting. You're going for a survey and collecting the data. You are collecting the data from Instagram tweets, Instagram messages, or tweets, or stories, or video calls. Any of these things are. And let me again give you a small example. So suppose you call any customer care. Maybe you're calling to Airtel customer care. What is the first thing which you hear? Can anyone of you tell me what is the first thing which you hear? I request all of you to please send messages to everyone so that I can view it on my screen and so that all of us can view it. Language preference, okay. Please just keep your messages to everyone. Just keep it to everyone so that everyone of us can see your messages. Language preference. Thank you for calling. This call is being recorded. Okay, Divyanshi. She has actually, Mudit has actually given me the correct answer. This call is being recorded for future training purposes. So actually, they take it as a data. They listen. Do you think that people actually sitting there and listening to these audios? No. It's actually being converted into text first using this speech recognition, which we did right now. And then these texts are actually used. I'll show you all later how these small words, texts are used, and these are used for training the customer care work, the people who work for the customer care. So that is how interestingly they convert this audio calls into text first, then analyze these texts, right? There is no one sitting out there and listening to our entire conversations. There's no one, there's no so much of time for anyone to do that, right? Okay, so that is how you collect the data. Then you work on the quality of the data. So as I said, you are actually converting the audios to text. And when you convert into text, there's some kind of mistakes which is about to happen. Like over here, the XES was XES, right? So they convert these small errors and change these small errors, overcome these small errors, ambiguities, build a training model on these, trial run the model, and then use the final output and communicate it to the client. This is the entire process of data analysis and business analytics. So there are people who actually specialize in just one category. There are people who know all of it, but they just specialize in one part of it. So that comes very later. Then we have, so let's talk about now the different tools which you'll require in this entire process of data and business analytics. The very first is Excel. Excel is something which all of us should know, all of us uses, be it Microsoft, Google, to very small companies, all of these companies, all of the educational houses, everyone, hospitals, everywhere you go, Excel is being used. Even in our workplace, even in our homes, we use Excel. So Excel is a computerized version, electronic version of the spreadsheets which were used by accountants hundreds of years ago. So you can create reports very easily. You can carry out amazing analytics on your data. You can save the data very easily. You can have instant calculations. It helps you to work together through Excel Web. That is also being launched recently. You can use Excel Web and work together with your friends. That is how amazingly Excel puts everything into. And this is actually the first step towards your data and business analytics career. You have to, must know Excel. Okay. So let's talk about financial modeling. What is financial modeling? So financial modeling is actually, to keep it very simple, companies do financial modelings to have periodic reviews, like quarterly reports, yearly reports, and compare them with their previous quarters, previous years, gross profits, profits, costs, and all of these things. It's also used for valuations of assets and liabilities. All of these things are then put together and it's used to create, you know, financial budgets. So you have these quarterly estimates. If you see a business channel in the morning, at the end of the quarter, they'll be talking about TCS released its quarterly profit, this particular company released its quarterly profit, and it's so much higher than last year. That is how they actually use financial modeling and analytics together to put in everything together and for you to analyze that which company is better to invest in, right? Let me show you all a small example over here. So this is an FMCG data of an FMCG company. There are different clients, brands, volumes, gross sales, net sales made, cost of goods sold, all of these things. And I have more than 88,000 rows. So you can imagine the amount of data which I have imported in my Excel. Now, after a lot of steps, I've actually reached to this step wherein you can see I've got the gross profit for both the years 2015 and 2016. Now, suppose I send this to my manager and he wants to know that what was the gross profit in the month of August. He'll just click on this 8 and he'll get the gross profit of the month of August. Or maybe I want to know it for the month of December. This is the gross profit for my month of December, January. So that is how you actually get gross profits for different months. And suppose I want it for my client Mehta. So I just click on Mehta and I get the gross profit. This is how I will analyze that which client, which brand is giving me the highest profitability and which brand, which client is giving me the least profitability or I'm making a loss on it. And once I know that which place, which area I'm making loss in, I can work upon it. So this was something which was put together entirely, but I have actually used these slicers. This is known as pivot tables. I've all created it using Excel only. So you can imagine the power of Excel, right? So this is actually a part of financial modeling which you learn, which you do. So you can then analyze that which areas you have to work upon. Okay, so let's move to our next tool over here. Our next tool is very interesting, VBA. VBA is something which saves a lot of time. It automates all these tasks. Suppose there's a reporting which I have to do every month on my Excel and I have to spend 2-3 days on it. What say if I say that just with a single click of button, you can do the entire task at once. So if you're spending 2-3 days on it, you just spend 1 minute now using VBA. So just write a few lines of codes, very simple codes, and you convert your daily routine, mundane tasks into very, and it gives you 100% accuracy because there is no chance of any error because you have created the code very nicely. And that is how you save a lot of time, and it's very, very cost effective. Let me again show you a small example over here. So this is a sheet which I have created. I have just a few sheets over here with a topic on each of the sheets. For example, if I have 50 of these sheets and I want to create a hyperlink of all of these sheets, what do you mean by hyperlink? Suppose I just click on that and it directs me to sheet number 20. It directs me to sheet number 30. How do you do that? You have to add the hyperlink manually. Instead of adding it manually, and it might take you 1 minute, approximately 30 seconds to 1 minute to add the hyperlink. If I have to do that for 50 sheets, I'm actually wasting my 50 minutes. How do I improve on it? I write a few lines of codes for once, and then I'm sorted and I can do it any time of the day, just in a single click of button. So here is my small button. Here is my small button. I just click on it and it asks me, where do you want to insert this particular index? I just select a few range of cells, click on OK, and see, just in a second, it gave me all the hyperlinks. And suppose I want to go to sheet number 5, I just click on sheet 5 and I'm directed to sheet number 5. That is how brilliantly it works. It just took me maybe 1 hour to write the code, but then it saves me a lot of time for my future purposes. Right? This was a very small example of VBA. Let me give you another example as well. So here, I have to create a report, a monthly report for my manager and for my regional manager every month. I have to do that. And it takes me again, as I mentioned, 2-3 days to do. So how can I automate this again? It might take me 7-8 hours to create a macro, to create the entire VBA coding. But do you understand that just spending your 1 day, you're actually saving approximately 32 days of your entire year, 3 days around 1 year in 1 month. So it's actually saving so many days to yourself by just creating this amazing tool. So I'll just show you all. First is to import the data set. So I'll just import the data set. I'll select the files which I want to import. Click on OK. And in just a minute, they'll see the data has been imported successfully. And this entire step would have taken me approximately an hour to do. I had to import the data, align it together, change it into rows and columns. So much of work, so much of effort, right? Next, I want to create a report. So there are two places where my company works in America and Europe. Suppose I want to create it for America. I'll create the report. I'll just click on this button and just see in just a few seconds, the files have been created in your workbook directory. I'll show you all. This is my workbook directory. These are the files. So this is the file which I have to share to my manager. This is the file which I have to share to my manager. And this is the file which I have to share to my regional manager. See. So how beautifully this could have taken around again, maybe 2 days to create, but I just did it with just a single click of button. And these are the tasks. List of tasks so that you know that, okay, these were the tasks which I have performed. And if you want to clear it, I'll just click on this button and it's all cleared. So that is how interestingly I've designed this entire tool for me so that it makes my life easier. So that is how I use VBA. Again, something which saves a lot of time. Moving to our next tool, Python. Python is something which is very, very, very widely used nowadays. All the companies are wanting their employees to learn Python. In fact, they're hiring only those people who can use Python, because Python is something which is very widely used. It can be in web development, games development, in the world of finance, trading, machine learning, risk analytics. You just name it and Python is there for you. It has so many libraries. It's so vast. It's so amazing that you can do anything on it, right? And it's an open source. You do not need any money to install Python, and it handles large data sets amazingly. Okay. To this point, I have created a small code of Python for you all over here. And this is how to calculate the beta of a stock. So when I say beta of a stock, to keep it very simple, it's the risk measure of any particular share. So suppose here I'm using SBI, share of SBI, and I'm using the Nifty index, and I'm comparing SBI with respect to Nifty. So what I'll do is I have already run all my codes over here, and these are the SBI and Nifty prices from 2016 till yesterday. Today is Saturday, so anyway, the market is closed. So from 2016 till the very last day, I have all the prices over here. And this is how I've calculated my beta with just few lines of code. Now you all tell me any share, name of any share, please keep it to India only, restricted to NSE only. Tell me the name of any share, please, in the chat box, and use the chat box for everyone so that everyone of us can see your messages. Keep it to everyone, please. Okay, so I'm getting the share name of ITC, TCS. Okay, so let's talk about TCS. Actually, I'm deriving all the prices from Yahoo Finance. Okay, so it's linked to Yahoo Finance. So I'll just go on Yahoo Finance. I'll search for TCS over here. I'll search for TCS, and I'm working in India currently. So I'll be using this index, Nifty index, TCS.NS. This is the ticker name. What is the ticker name? The short name of every share which is there. So, okay, let's do it for TCS. TCS. Okay, I'll just run this code. It'll take, see, I have the price for TCS and for Nifty. So earlier the beta value for SBI was 1.36. Let's see how it changes for TCS. It's 0.629. The higher the beta value, the more variable the share price is. So just with a single click, I've written the code only once. I'm using it for my lifetime. This is how amazingly it works, right? So this is a small code which I've showed you for Python. You can do many, many, many such great things on Python very simply. Okay, let's move to our next tool over here, which is R programming. So what is R programming? It's exactly, it is somewhat like Python, but it's easier. You can say the language is a little easier. Again, you can perform many, many tasks on R programming, used for machine learning, data cleansing, data wrangling. Data wrangling is what? It's converting your raw data into a useful, desirable format. So maybe in rows and columns. Web scraping. What is web scraping? Web scraping is very, very interesting. Web scraping is something, to keep it simple, getting data from the internet. So it seems very simple, but actually it takes a lot of time and it's very interesting to do. And it's also compatible with many other languages. It's an open source, you can download it. All these companies, all the great companies are using R programming. It's free to use. You can download it freely on your on your PCs. Next, come up with machine learning. So what is machine learning? Machine learning is algorithm which you create to predict future, to carry out predictive analytics without any human intervention. When I say no human intervention, once you write the algorithm, once you write the code, and then you give the data to your algorithm and it's done, right? Also, there is a continuous improvement happening in machine learning. So suppose when I showed you all the speech recognition, I said that this is continuously improving. You get these updates every day, right? So this is how they're developing the algorithms every day. And it has wide application. Let me give you an example. How many of you know about the spam box? So in your emails, you have this spam box. So any mails like you will win 1 crore of lottery, or maybe jackpot, hit a jackpot, call on this number and hit a jackpot. All of these random emails which you get, these are straight away directed to the spam box, right? These are straight away directed to the spam box. How is this happening? Again, the feature of NLP, natural language processing. And again, machine learning is involved over here. So what they do is they analyze these texts. Okay, and if they are getting these texts like hit a jackpot, lottery, 1 crore, all of these words, when they suddenly crop up, these are actually straight away, what the Google does is straight away send these mails to the spam box. Have you ever felt that there was an important mail and it was by mistake directed to the spam box? Any one of you ever feel this? Yes, so many of you are writing yes. So it has happened to many of us that it was an important mail for us, but then it was directed to the spam box. That is why I'm saying that it is continuously developing, right? It's never perfect. It can never be perfect. It will have to develop every day, every time, right? So that is how it's continuously developing. Okay, now let's take an example. So here is a small data set on Titanic. All of you might have seen Titanic. And all of you know what is the tragic end of Titanic. So I have all the passengers, list of all the passengers traveling in Titanic. So here I have the name of passengers, the passenger ID, and all of these information. On the basis of this information, I want to actually find out that who all survived and who all didn't survive as per my analysis. And I want to understand that which of the characteristics and feature were really important in the survival of a person. So I have passenger ID. Do you all think passenger ID is of any help? No, it's just a roll number given to us. I don't think it's of any help. So I just simply ignore it. Then I have passenger class. Passenger class can be first class, second class, third class. So what is the, how can you relate this to the survival? So yes, obviously person traveling in first class will be given the right, at that point of time, they were actually given the right to the lifeboat first. They almost all the people traveling in the first class were saved in Titanic. Then we have the names. Does name play any role? No. But the one thing which plays the role is the title, Mr., Miss., Doctor, Master. So what I did was in this particular entire model, I actually removed the first title. I just took out the Mr., Mrs., Doctor and used these for my analysis rather than using the names. Then we have the gender. So again, females were given preference over males in the lifeboats. Then age, younger children were given preference. And then we have siblings, spouses, parent, children traveling, fare. Again, fare is related to passenger class. If your fare is higher, you are most likely to travel in the first class. if your fare is zero, whose fare can be zero in a Titanic? Whose fare can be zero? Just let me know in the chat box. This is a very logical thing. No, no. Captain, staff, very good, very good. Crew members, amazing. You guys are amazing. So crew members, their salary will be their fare will be zero. So they were the ones actually given the last chance. They were the last ones to be saved. So only few crew members survived. Passengers, most of them survived, but the crew members couldn't make it, right? So thank you so much, everyone. So this is how I used this data and created a model. I'll not read through all the models. There were actually 5-6 models which I had to come up to reach my best estimate over here, right? And I'll just show you all that which characteristics in my model were the most desirable ones. So in my model, the passenger class, age, parents, number of parents and children. So basically, if you're traveling in passenger class 2 or 1, you're most likely to be saved, survive, you will survive. Lower the age, higher the chance that you will survive. This is how I actually analyzed the entire data set, right? Okay, so I'll just show you all what was my, so this was the entire model which I created, and let me show you all what was my accuracy rate. So my accuracy rate was 80%. What is this accuracy rate which I'm talking about? So when I created this model, I already had the actual results with me. What is the actual result? Who actually survived and who didn't. But I ignored that and I created my own model. I created my own model, and on the basis of that, it compared the actual results with my expected results. And when you compare them, you get the accuracy rate. So I was 80% accurate in my entire model, right? That is how you create these models. So I'll just show you all here. Titanic, this was the actual survive. 0 is for the non-survival, 1 is for the survival. This is the actual survive result, and these are the predictions which I made. So this is a model which I made. There are people who are making better models. There are people, so you have to keep on working upon it. Okay, so here's my next question to you all. When you, suppose you're visiting a new city and you want to visit a hotel, what are the features, what are the reviews you look for when you visit a hotel, when you're booking a hotel? Just a word, just give me random words. Just the words. Location, rating. I want the words, not the rating. Rating is something which you can just see there. Budget food. Okay, service, experience, comfort, central of the city, rent, rating, food, price, cost. Very good. So these are the few things. Okay, people are sharing. Okay, room, comfortable. Great. So what if I say that you don't have to put in so much of effort into reading the reviews? I have collected all the reviews in one place and I've changed it into a word cloud. What is this word cloud? Wherein you can just see what were the words which appeared the most in these reviews. I've done it using my machine learning in R or in Python. Any of these two, you can do it. So I'll just show you all this. This is the word cloud. This is the word cloud of all the reviews which I've got from a particular hotel. I took all the reviews in one place, analyzed it, and just changed it. And it was not just a easy task. You have to actually clean the data. Maybe there is spelling mistakes. People are writing clean as C-L-E-E-N. So I have to change it, right? So those things are there. So what all the words we can see is room, clean, bed, bathroom, comfortable, bathtub, facilities. So all of spacious, nice. But so after reading this, are you willing to visit this hotel? I am willing to visit because it's written comfortable. This is what I want. I want it to be clean. I want it to be spacious. So I am ready to visit. You don't actually have to, read through hundreds and thousands of reviews now. Right? This is known as a word cloud, and you can create it with your Python or R programming, anything. It's a part of machine learning. Right? Okay, great. So let's move on to the next slide, which is our next tool over here, SQL. So SQL is again something, it's a You can say it's an inherent part of data analysis. The large amount of data which you cannot import in Excel. So Excel has a limitation of only 1 million rows. If you have data with 10 million rows, 20 million rows, you can use SQL for that. All the companies, believe me, all the companies, YouTube, Netflix, Instagram, all these companies, Google, Microsoft, just name it, they all of these use SQL, right? It's so easy. Words like select, delete, insert, retrieve, all of these small, small English words are used to create amazing and very simple code lines, right? And it's very great for data manipulation, data storage, retrieving of the data information. Amazing, right? Let's move on to the next step, which is data visualization. So once I have this beautiful insight, I have to present it to my client. I have to present it to my manager. How do I do that? Will the manager be interested in these numbers, or will the manager be interested in amazing graphs? Obviously, graphs. We see, it is what we see that we feel, right? Generally, it's that. So when you see a beautiful graph, when you see a beautiful visualization in front of you, you actually believe that particular person. You actually believe that, okay, let me go with this particular idea. So I'll show you quickly. I'll show you a small dashboard, which I created using Power BI. So this is Power BI. I hope it's visible to everyone. Okay. So here we have, I have the data set of the number of apartments which were sold in these different cities. And this is the graph. This is the region-wise report from 1995 to 2015. Now, suppose I just wanted from 2000. So I have created a slider over here. This is very simple to use. Anyone can use it. So I'll just slide this and I get the data from 2000. See, my graph has also changed and I'm getting data only from 2000 onwards. Suppose I just want data and my manager just wants to look into Greater Manchester and see how it works. So I'll just select Greater Manchester and see it's redirected to this particular sheet. And you can see year-wise the sales volume, year-wise, date-wise, the sales volume of number of apartments sold in Greater Manchester. Right? You can do it for all. You can do it for any. You can do it for one particular year also. You can do it for one particular year also. See, for 2002, this was the sales. So this is how amazingly you can create an interactive dashboard for your client, your manager. They just click a few buttons over here and they get a useful insight out of it. Right? Instead of going through all of these numbers, it's very easy to just go through this particular chart over here. Okay. So let's move to our very next tool over here, which is MS Office. So MS Office is something which all of us must know. There are some unexplored features which are there in MS Office. For example, mail merge. It's a part of MS Office. It's a part of Word, which all of us does not know, but we should know, right? MS Office is an integrated part. Then we have G Suite. G Suite is something which all the businesses are now using. What is this cloud service which you talk about? Unlimited storage. You can store your photos and everything, your data, and it is completely hassle-free and it has a proper top-notch security. So you need not worry about your confidentiality of your information, right? Next, Tally. Tally is for, you know, data, just for bookkeeping and keeping all your accounts together in one place. So after all of these different tools which we have gone through and all of these things, let's talk about the job opportunities which are there in the market currently. So first of all, I'll give you a very small example and then I'll just read through these facts, okay? So you all remember the days when you had just 1 GB for the entire month. Do you guys remember? There was time when we had just 1 GB for the entire month to use. And we used to shout on our siblings that, why are you playing on internet? We have to do that, do this. And we used to have these fights. Yes, all of us remember those days. Okay, 5 years back. Okay. So, okay, great. So all of us remember those days when we used to just have 1 GB internet. Then a miracle happened and Reliance Jio came in. Do you all know Reliance Jio? एक दिन ऐसे हुआ सपने में मुकेश अंबानी के आया कि हम सबको फ्री में इंटरनेट देंगे. क्या ऐसा हुआ था? नहीं. मुकेश अंबानी, द रिचेस्ट मैन ऑफ इंडिया, ही रियलाइज्ड दैट डेटा इज द न्यू ऑयल, डेटा इज द न्यू ऑक्सीजन ऑफ द कंप्यूटराइज्ड पीरियड. ही, वेयर ऑल अदर टेलीकॉम कंपनीज वर अंडर एस्टिमेटिंग द पावर ऑफ डेटा, at that point of time Mukesh Ambani realized that the importance of data is so huge. He then gave us free internet. That was the point of time when we all shifted from our current whatever users, telecom users, most of the people, to Reliance Jio. And now you can see the net worth of Reliance Jio. And that was the point of time where the two biggest, one of the biggest companies, telecom companies, Vodafone and Idea, they actually merged. They actually had to merge because of the losses, right? So actually you can imagine the forward looking, how predictive his mind was, his mind and his analytics team. They actually realized the importance of data at that point of time, right? So let me give you a few fact check over here. So Indian big data analytics is about to reach $16 billion by 2025, according to NASSCOM. And because there is so much of dearth of talent in analytics sector, India has ranked as 58th globally. And it is just slightly better than Nigeria and Philippines. You can imagine the population of India, and then you can again imagine there was a shortfall of 2,30,000 jobs last year in big data analytics world in India. And it costs Indian firms around rupees 332 billion every year. So if I am having a data with myself and I'm not being able to utilize it, it's the biggest drawback which my company faces right now. So you can imagine how important analytics is, not only in small businesses, big businesses, everywhere data is very, very important, right? Okay. Great. So these are the different job opportunities which I've talked about. Now let's move to the companies which are hiring data and business analysts in India. These are the various companies. I've just made a small collage for you all. These are the various companies throughout the world who are actually hiring analysts. And if you are in insurance sector or be it in healthcare sector, everywhere you need analysts. Now, how to become a data and business analyst being at this particular level? Right? Okay. So have a good understanding of all the tools which I've mentioned above. It was Excel, VBA, Python, R programming, SQL, Power BI. All of these tools you should have a good understanding of. You should at least run it, right? You can understand the interface, you can run the codes and everything. But your best friend is always one. You have many friends, but best friend is only one best friend, right? So you have to make any one of these tools as your best friend. When I say best friend, is that you are very flexible, you are very comfortable with this particular tool. So let me give you my example. When I started my journey when I was in first year. So I started learning Excel, I started learning R programming, I started learning VBA. So I know all of these. I know Python, I know how to do machine learning, predictive analytics, Tableau, Power BI. But my best friends are only two. I have Excel and R programming. These two are my best friends. So I'm very comfortable with Excel and R programming. But that does not mean I cannot run a code on Python. I just showed you all. That does not mean I cannot do Power BI. I showed you all, right? I can do it. But my best friends are Excel and R programming. So you have a good understanding of your own business domain. Suppose I want to go into the healthcare sector. I want to go into the finance sector, in the risk management, in maybe digital marketing. I have to have that business acumen of that particular business domain which I'm entering into. Have a curious mindset. Have an analytical mindset behind. And have a curious mindset. You're always running after business problem. How to solve these different business problems, right? Spend approximately 2-3 hours every day of your life. You're not just reading and writing boring lectures and everything. No, don't do that. Actually apply them in these particular fields. Whatever data you have, and where you'll get the data, I'll just come to it. Whatever small data you have, just use it, analyze something out of it, derive a conclusion out of it. Okay, so it seems very I don't know whether should I share it or not, but this was something I did it in my college actually. So my birthday comes in September. I have lots of friends, family members whose birthday is in September, right? So I took all their data, I analyzed and I derived this conclusion that according to Hindu mythology or rituals maybe, there is a wedding season in December happening. Okay, so many of the couples, they get married in December and they have their babies by September. This was actually analysis which I derived when I was in college. Like, this was my first data which I used. Okay, moving on. So how, as a beginner, can you grow your skills? How can you grow your skills? There is a platform called Kaggle. Write it down, all of you, please. It's a Kaggle where you can visit, and it's open to everyone. People from US, UK, Australia, India, all over the world, they use this. And when I say people, they're actually big, big analysts. These analysts are the one who predicts US elections, who will win the next US election, who will win the next football cup. They are the analysts, okay? So here what happens is that big companies, they post their business problems and they give you offer on it. Suppose if you give me a solution, I'll give you, so you can see the amount of challenges which are here, and it's approximately 1.5, you can see 1.5 million of dollars which I can get from this if I solve the business problem. There are many people who are competing and solving this business problem, but only one solution is. But we are not focused on here. We are focused on here. Getting started. You learn all of these tools on your own. You perform, or you just get a grasp of it, and then you open your Kaggle account. Once you open your Kaggle account, you have millions of data sets there, which you can use easily for free. So this Titanic data set, which you all saw, this I took from Kaggle. I took from Kaggle itself. I have a screenshot of it over here. So you can see Titanic. Machine learning from disaster. So this is from where I took this Titanic data set from. You just have to go to this getting started category and you'll get all the data for a beginner level, right? And you can use this data for your own, creating your own models and deriving useful insights out of it. So this was a step, head start I've given you. How to first, what it takes to become an analyst, even you at your stage can become an analyst being a college student, and then how to apply it, how to grow your skill. It should be about learning experiences, gaining experiences, and not about earnings, right? So it is all about learning experience. With experience, your earnings will definitely come. Okay, great. So it was, I just have till here. Anyone of you, if you have any questions, I'm open to all of your questions, and you can ask your questions to XCS Queries. I hope the seminar was really, really informative and interesting for you all.
Thank you, ma'am, for your insights. Today we learned a lot about the details and the intricacies of data and about how analytics basically surrounds us everywhere. So we will now be having a short question and answer session, and I request all participants who wish to ask questions to send a message via the chat box.
Kaggle or Free Code Camp? You can use any, so see, you have Kaggle, you have GitHub, you have many such platforms. Why did I take example of Kaggle is that being at a beginner level, it's very simple to use, right? So almost all of them start with Kaggle. So that is the reason, but yeah, there are many things. Java, definitely. So Java is, you can say, just a step towards Python. So if you know Python, Java is nothing for you. Like where you are like writing 2-3 lines of codes in Java, you just write one line of code, 3+5 simply in Python. So that is how Python is more, you can say, flexible with that. Is data analytics necessary for chartered accountants, for CAs? So let me give you an example. If you are a CA, okay, and you are conducting, maybe you are a part of a, let's suppose, of a portfolio, you are a portfolio manager, okay, of a particular company. So which shares to invest in, which property should you should invest in? How do you decide that? It's all based on the history, the historical data, right? And you're analyzing that data. If you're carrying out an audit, for example, how do you carry out the audit? It's all about data and how to analyze that. So it's all about that. So, okay, let me just give you 2 minutes time and talk about myself. So as XCS mentioned, I was a part of Bachelors of Commerce BCom. I started in first year with actuarial science, and maybe somewhere around at the end of my first year, I got hold of this Excel and R programming, and I started learning. Right? I never had this experience of coding in my school. So in my school, I just use laptop maybe for you can say Facebook or maybe for playing games. Nothing more than that. Okay. So I started learning Excel, I started learning R programming, I started learning VBA in my college, where I was just a person who was not into so much of technology, but now I'm really, really comfortable around it. So it's all about how much you love it, how much you have this curious mindset, and how much you're ready to practice it every day. It's all about that. Because if I can do it, you all can do it very, very easily, to be very honest, right? Which tool should we start from? You should start always from Excel. Always. Excel is your best friend. Like, when I say this, Excel is an old friend. So Excel is considered to be an old best friend, school best friend. Okay. You should always start with Excel, your journey, always.
Also, ma'am, there is a question. The students who want to know which institute or maybe, yeah, which institute they should basically choose to go for these data analytics courses.
So guys, all of them, many of the institutes are offering these courses. You go to Udemy, Coursera, many of these institutes, and there are people who are offering these courses. You can open YouTube and there are, you know, many videos around that. But so I can just give you like what we do is we have this integrated program of data and business analytics. And it's a 9 months program, especially for students who just have passed out their 12. So they are in their undergraduates. So we actually cater to undergraduates, and we have all of these courses, as I mentioned above. And we have a team of 8 to 10 teachers. It again depends upon you. It's all about your curiosity, how much you are willing to learn. There are many places you can go for. I suggested that what we do, we have this 9 months integrated program in data and business analytics together. Okay. So yeah, you can visit, you can just type it and you can get, just type data analysis on Google and you'll get it. Right. Okay. Thank you for the question. Which YouTube channel do you suggest? So Vibhuti, YouTube, there are multiple YouTube channels. For each software, you have one channel. So you can just type and you can get one. Ma'am, if you could please share from exactly, okay. See, knowledge of multiple platforms, Shubham, very, very good question. Actually, this was something which I was also very confused about. But as I said, you should have a lot of friends, but you should have only one best friend. So it's exactly what's in my case. Okay, I know how to write codes in Python. I know how to write codes in R programming. I know how to write codes in SQL. I know all of these. Actually, you know, these are somewhere linked to each other. Once you start somewhere, all of these are linked to each other. If you're learning VBA, for example, it will become really, really, really simple for you to learn R programming. Really simple for you to learn Python. If you know Java, Python will be very simple for you. So everything are actually interlinked, but at the end of the day, you have to focus on what is important to you. And you have to suppose R programming is what I do my work on. I did this entire modeling, which I showed you for Titanic on my R programming. I can do the same thing on Python, but if in R programming, it is taking me maybe one day, on Python, it might take me 1.5 to 2 days. Right, there are some things which I cannot do in R programming, I can do in Python only, because only Python offers that, and vice versa. So you should at least know, at least you should understand what the tool is, but make one of it as your best friend. When I say best friend, you should know everything about R programming, like in my case, and others are just your friends. So you're just knowing a few aspects of it. Python, you can start with Python directly, no point in going for Java there. Sequence to learn analytics, as I mentioned, the tools over there on my slides, that is the proper sequence. Which is better? You can go for MSc in data science only if you have done bachelor's in science, right? Then only you can go for it. Yeah, Pratyush, I mentioned it earlier. So, top recruiters, I showed you on my slides. These are the top recruiters in India across the globe. All of these recruit people from India itself. We have IBM, we have all the banks actually. Then we have, these are the Indian companies actually. Okay, so you start with Excel. If you don't have any, like I mentioned you about my case, I also didn't have any experience in coding. I started with Excel, then with VBA, then with R programming. Mahima, everything is over here. Just, you know, you can contact through this particular page. We can put down our numbers in the chat box. So you can, if you are interested, right? Okay, so I will just want to add one thing over here. It's all about from where you start and how you start. It doesn't matter that do you have the coding experience or are you so much into computers or laptops. If you're not, so people call, even if you're not able to do a simple thing such as payment, and all of these basic things, even if that is the case, you can still learn, because it's not about coding, it's about analyzing. How better you understand your business, how better you understand being a CA, how better you understand the different, you can say, tricks, different risks, how can you manage your risks well. If you are in healthcare sector, how good of a knowledge you have in that particular domain. Even nowadays, psychologists are using data analysis across everywhere. How better you understand your business, how your mind works, how, and it's again important that you're not losing out anywhere, in the sense that even if you're not making the code correctly, you're getting a lot of errors. Still, if you're not working upon it, if you're still working upon it and you're not ready to give up, then you can definitely just do wonders in this. It doesn't matter if my friend writes codes amazingly, and I'm not such great person in writing the codes, but I have a really good analytical, logical mindset. I keep on asking the questions. I have this problem solving nature. I will be better off than my friend, to be very honest. Mukesh Ambani does not know how to write a code, but he has this analyzing power, right? So, okay. Thank you all so much. I hope all of you enjoyed our small webinar. It feels really, really great to come back to my college. Thank you so much, XCS, for giving us this amazing opportunity. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for such an informative and enriching session. We are sure that the takings from this webinar will hold our audiences in good stead for the years to come. And we are grateful to get this opportunity to learn from you today. And we really look forward to hosting you in the future as well. Thank you to all our attendees for having joined us today and showing us support even in these trying times. We hope that this webinar was a great learning experience for you as well. We attach great value to your suggestions about our event, and therefore we request you all to fill up the feedback form which is sent in the chat box. Also, kindly note that credits will only be awarded if the feedback form is duly filled. Please note that a minimum of 4 webinars are to be attended in order to avail the credits. Your attendance for this webinar has also been noted, and the procedure to avail the credits will be informed to you when we resume classes in an offline mode. Kindly fill the form that has been sent in the chat box. And the next webinar by TCC Management Systems begins at 1 p.m. And those who are wishing to attend the same may leave the meeting and rejoin the meeting at 10 minutes prior to the scheduled time. Thank you for joining us today, and we really look forward to seeing you all in our future events. You may leave the meeting now.